So as I was saying, those of you who tried to email me or Mary for the last couple of weeks will find that you didn't get any replies, and that's because we haven't seen your emails yet because our satellite is not working at the moment. So that's my law of attraction. So something's going on there. It might have meant that I needed some peace the last 2 weeks. I'd like to thank those of you for your donations too. Last time we were together, because that's enabled us actually to plan not only these two next events here in Yulo, but also a weekend in Brisbane as well, which we've already prepaid for. So that'll be, I think it's March the 7th and 8th. Yeah. Where is James? A month from today, March 7th and 8th.
And Port Macquarie?
Yeah, we also have something planned in Port Macquarie as a result of your donations. That's happening on 1st of March, Sunday the 1st of March at 10 a.m. The details Peter will be sending out shortly, so that'll happen sometime over the next few weeks. So Port Macquarie is what, 5 hours north of Sydney, isn't it? So for those of you who are driving from Sydney or from Gosford or wherever you're going from, those of you might find it a bit more convenient to travel 5 hours instead of 15 or whatever you're doing now. The other thing that I wanted to mention too is that quite a lot of your donations now are being used to send DVDs overseas. What we're doing is we've got different people in different locations overseas. A fellow in the US who converts all the DVDs into USA format, which is called NTSC, and then he distributes them. And then we also have somebody in Greece and someone in England doing the same thing. So that's quite good. So there's these kind of things. All of our discussions that we're taping at the moment are all going overseas as well as in Australia. So that's really good. We also have planning another event in Tasmania, because there's about 90 or so people who are interested in coming along to those at this point. So that'll be happening probably sometime in April. So that's what we've got planned for the future. And I just think I'll briefly mention next fortnight's discussion here in Yulo. It will be called Lessons in Love. The weekend will be called Lessons in Love. The first day will be Lessons in Natural Love. And the second day will be Lessons in Divine Love. So you might find that interesting. And it'll be a practical discussion about natural love and how to display natural love in your life, and also a practical discussion about the different nuances between natural love and divine love attitudes that you can develop within yourself. So that'll be part of the week's discussion. This is like a fortnight's time from today. Jenny?
How do you feel the planet's going? Do you feel like the war is raging and there's lots happening? How do you feel they're going?
I feel the only war that's worth worrying about is the war that's going on within your soul. And I feel for many that's doing quite well, as you all realise. There's a big raging going on for many of you already, isn't there? Between what your head is demanding of you and what your heart's trying to tell you to do. And I think it's doing really well, actually. I'm pretty pleased about how things are changing. Now, I know that the changes are just happening. You know, obviously there are a lot of people in deep fear still. And while that remains, obviously that's going to generate lots of issues on the earth, unpalatable issues over the coming years. But while there's ones like yourselves who are actually letting that war of the soul continue and working through your emotions, it's really, really great. So I'm really happy about how things are going, actually. Isn't it? Yeah, really happy. Now, today's discussion is about the law of attraction. And not the law of attraction, the secret style. This is the real law of attraction, the one that really happens within your soul. And so I want to spend a lot of time today explaining to you the principles of the law of attraction. Now, what we'll do is we'll do the session in the reverse order that we did last fortnight, and that is, instead of having a discussion first, we'll do a presentation first about the law of attraction, and then we'll have our discussion about it. So in the second part, that's the part where I'd like you to ask as many questions about the law of attraction, even your own law of attraction, if you would like to, in the second part of our discussion. What I want to do firstly, though, is present to you the actual law of attraction principles, if you like, based upon your soul and how that works, and so that you have a deeper understanding about how the law of attraction actually works in your life. Does that sound fine?
Yes. Yeah.
Awesome. All of you have a handout being given to you? No? Those of you who haven't, put your hand up, and where are the handouts that are left over? Because we printed. We printed out 120, but I think there's 117 people coming. So I may need to print out some more after or at the break. All right. Number one thing about the law of attraction is what you really want, you get. Now, how many of you feel you're getting what you really want right at the moment? Some of you, but not many. So, absolutely every one of you who didn't put your hand up, you do not understand the number one rule of the law of attraction. What you really want, you are already right now getting. That is the number one principle of the law of attraction. So then a lot of people go with that. Well, how does that work? Like, I really want to have $1 million and I don't have that. I really want to have a new car, but I don't have that. I really want to have a relationship that's working, but I don't seem to have that. You know, I really want to have children that love me, but they all seem to be angry at me. I don't have that. So how can you say I'm getting what I really want right now? How many of you feel that way? How many of you feel that way? How can you say that I'm getting what I really want? Yeah? The truth is you are getting what you really want right now. And that's very, very important truth to understand right at the beginning. But it's not what you really want here. This is the problem. Is that we think that if we think it's what we want, then we should get it. But it's not about that. It's about a thing called soul condition. And later in our discussion today, we're going to focus on what the soul condition really is. Now, in The Secret, who of you have seen The Secret? Most of you? Good, that's great. Now, in The Secret, it recommends that you think about things a lot, doesn't it? Visualize, conceive, think about things, and then what will you think about, you will get. Now, how many of you have tried that? Particularly after seeing The Secret. And how many of you found that's really, really successful? Okay, so not many. So why is it that not many find it successful? There's only about 4 people who put up their hand in that second question, by the way. How come out of 100 people who've tried it, only 4 people have seemed to work for? It's a good question, isn't it? So then it feels like, oh, I'm being fed a furphy here. Furphy, AJ word furphy, means I'm being fed a distraction. I'm being fed a lie. And a lot of times we feel that, don't we? That we've been fed a distraction here. This secret thing, which is about this law of attraction thing, doesn't really work either. It's another one of these new age things that doesn't work, you know. But the truth is, when we understand it completely, you will see that it works perfectly. But the key is to understand it completely. And that's why I wanted to have this discussion with you today. The law of attraction is a very, very important law. It's a law, actually, that governs the universe. It governs the universe in the physical state, in the state we're in, but it also governs the universe for all of the spirits who have come with us today. It actually controls the spirit world as well. And all the soul states, the states above the spirit world, it also controls. And they're all controlled by this law of attraction. It's a very, very important law to understand. And it's a very important law to use in a way that will help you get closer to God. So that's why we want to discuss it, because it's actually a law that can assist you to get closer to God. In fact, I would call the law of attraction God's messenger of truth to you. Right, so second thing to remember about the law of attraction. The law of attraction is God's messenger of truth to you. So the first statement I said is what you really want, you get. And the second statement I said was that God's messenger of truth to you is this law of attraction. That what you really want, you get. So then we have to define what is real, don't we? What do we mean by what we really want? Well, your soul condition defines what you really want, not your intellect. Now we need to work out what's the difference between the two. What's the difference between our intellect and our soul condition? But our soul condition I have defined, and you'll notice I've put it into the section, what is soul condition in your handout. And notice I've said it's the sum total of your passions, your desires, your longings, your moral beliefs, your moral condition, your aspirations, your pursuits, your emotions, your feelings, your intentions, your loves, your dislikes and hates, your fears, your religious beliefs, your scientific beliefs, your love beliefs, your mental aspirations and beliefs, which come from the soul. All of those things all together are what is your soul condition. And your soul condition actually causes all of your attractions. It is not what you think you want, it is what you really want at the feeling or emotional core of you at the soul level that defines how the law of attraction works in your life. Now, is everyone getting that? Now, it's one thing to get that here, isn't it? Quite another thing to actually feel the truth of that here. So, if I am in a relationship, for example, that I'm not finding fulfilling, it's what my soul condition wants right now in order to do something, in order to actually clear something, in order to access truth within me. Remember I said, the second thing I said, and I might write that down to you, is the law of attraction is God's messenger of truth to you. That's really important to understand. So, the law of attraction is giving me what I really want, and of course, if you think about it, God wants you to be real. That's the first thing God wants you to be. So, for example, many of us have anger in our hearts towards God, for example. Because we feel really annoyed that God hasn't given us what we want, that God hasn't given us a little rule book that we can say, well, there's God's laws and I can follow that, right? How many of you feel really frustrated about that? Where's my guidebook? Like, there's all these laws AJ's telling me about, nobody's told them to me before. What's God doing, right? Like, where's the, like, surely you should have, like, given an instruction manual, you know, when they build a car, an instruction manual comes. Somebody build this. An instruction manual should have come, right? And the truth is, that instruction manual has come, but we just don't recognize it, and the instruction manual is the law of attraction. God's messenger of truth to your soul is the instruction manual. But we often don't think of it that way. We think of it as a pain in the neck. And so what we do is we look at the instruction manual, the law of attraction, that's attracted all these bad relationships, all of this bad financial situation, all these other things into my life. And so what do? We look at it and say, don't like that instruction manual. Give me another one. And God said, no, no, no. This is your instruction manual. What I'm trying to do, and this is God's message to you, what I'm trying to do is tell you the truth about yourself. And the law of attraction, this law that operates on your true condition, your soul condition, tells you the truth about yourself. you, in fact, can use this law to find out the truth about everything within yourself, if you have the courage to do that. So it's really like God saying to you, here's the instruction manual, and us having the courage to open them. Oh, AJ's got, oh, he's got anger with God, you know. And we start reading the instruction manual, which is actually a very personal instruction manual. It's not an instruction manual given to all of you, like, as one manual, because all of us are different, aren't we? We all have different emotions, we have different feelings, we have different passions, we have different desires. Even in our pristine condition, we have different personalities. So, does it make any sense for God to give one instruction manual? Doesn't really, does it? So what he's done is he's provided this law of attraction which operates on your personal soul condition. It's your personalized instruction manual that you can have the ability to open up and have a good look at what you really are. Now, the big problem is that most of us open something up and have a look at what we really are. You know, when we go to a mirror in the morning and we have a look, we're not that happy with what we see. And so what are we tempted to do then? We're tempted to say, the mirror's a bad idea, right? How many of you have given up the mirror altogether? Yeah. It's very hard to give up because we always want to see what somebody else is seeing. But if we have the courage to look at God's instruction manual, the law of attraction, which is operating on the soul condition, then we can see what God is trying to tell us about the truth about our own life, about our own condition. Now, you think about that from a positive point of view, that's very powerful, isn't it? That means that every single one of us here has a personal instruction manual which we can actually look at every single moment of every single day. That's a very powerful place to be in, if you see your life like that. But most of us don't see our life like that. Most of us see our life totally the opposite way, and that is that I'm not responsible for what's around me. Everybody else is responsible for what's around me. And so we try to make everyone else responsible, including God, and we don't see ourselves as a powerful creator. We start seeing ourselves as the person that everybody kicks around, that everybody manipulates and controls, don't we? We start seeing ourselves as a victim of life rather than the creator of our own existence. Now, this law, the law of attraction, which operates upon the soul condition, is telling you that actually, no, you are the creator of your life, but not here. It is here that's creating your life. And if you allow yourself to ponder about that and really take that into account, your life can change very, very rapidly. So what kind of things are actually part of your law of attraction? There's huge mountains of things. In the section under scope of the law of attraction, notice down the page, I've said everything on earth and in the spirit world, so all of our spirit friends that are here today, even in the spirit world, everything surrounding you is the result of your law of attraction. So how many of you have a nasty neighbour? A few of you have a nasty neighbour? That's your law of attraction. How many of you have had a father who's been angry? How many of you have had a father who's been... That's now your law of attraction. How many of you had relationships that have never been satisfying? That's your law of attraction. You created it. You created it. You created it. Do you get that? So you see what we're often doing, we're saying, no, how can you say that, AJ? That's not fair. I didn't make him be angry. I don't want him to be angry with me. Why is he angry with me? You created it. There's something in you that causes him to believe he can get angry with you and get away with it. There's something in you that allows that. How many of you have been cheated on by a partner? Almost half, nearly half of the audience. You created it. How can you say that? They're the one who did the cheating. How can you say that you created it? Well, there was something inside of your soul that attracted it. something inside of you that was triggered by that event that you created. You created that person. You created even the relationship. Does that make sense? You created it. Like I said, everything surrounding you that is happening to you, every single relationship in your life, every single person, every single event, your every single personality, every single trauma, every single good thing that happens in your life is all created by your law of attraction, by your soul condition.
Even as a child?
As a child is a little different. So this is as an adult. I'm talking about as an adult. As a child, it's very much your parents' laws of attraction that create things that are going on inside of you as a child. Right? And this is where, when we have the discussion about parenting and children, you'll find that as parents we have a huge responsibility, because we are actually not only creating the law of attraction for ourselves, but by just bringing the child into our environment, we are now creating a law of attraction for our child. So I'm talking to a group of adults here, and everything that is right now in your life is created by your law of attraction. And your law of attraction is God's messenger of truth to you to help you release from yourself emotions that are disharmonious with love and to allow emotions that are harmonious with love to enter you. This is the purpose of your law of attraction.
Could some of the emotions be from a past life that we need to deal with in this life?
And in a previous talk, which you might like to look at, I've said there is no past lives.
Yeah.
But many of the emotions are, the reason why many people feel there are past lives is that there are spirits attached to them, and those spirits have their own law of attraction, and those spirits are certainly attached to you through your law of attraction too. So for instance, if you get a feeling that you've had a past life and you were murdered in a past life and you had a certain feeling of terror associated with that, then that terror was the law of attraction that attracted the spirit to you. And it's that emotion, the soul condition inside of you, that have made that attraction occur. Does that make sense? Right. So everything is based still on the law of attraction. What's happening between you and even in the spirit world is due to the law of attraction. Everything. So if somebody comes up to you and says, oh, you've got three spirits with you, and one of them is really angry with men, and one of them is really angry about this issue, and one's really sad, all you need to do is say, all right, I'm really angry with men. These are my law of attractions. Does that make sense? Just like they would be here on Earth. Same thing. What you're attracting, you will attract both in spirit world and in here on the Earth. And you will attract spirits from the spirit world with the same law of attraction that you attract people on Earth to you as well. How many of you had an event last week which caused a little bit of anger, right, to rise in you? Most of us, right? Okay. That was your law of attraction. And in fact, your anger was your resistance to the law of attraction. We'll talk about that in a minute. So, does everyone understand the difference between what I'm saying and what you've probably been taught about the law of attraction? The law of attraction is not something you can mentally construct. It's something that happens at the soul condition, which is to do with your emotions, your passions, your desires. Everything that's happening inside of you is what governs your law of attraction. So everyone understands that? Okay. Now you notice there's a section that I've made under what is soul condition. And notice I've listed the things that can change your soul condition. You notice that? Now I won't discuss all of those at the moment, but it's very, very important that you understand the things that can change your soul condition the most rapidly. If you're attracting a negative event or a negative people into your life, do you want to change that now, or do you want to change that gradually over about 50 years? What would you prefer? Now, wouldn't you? Okay, so therefore it would make sense to use the method that's the most rapid method, wouldn't it? To work on your soul condition. Wouldn't that make sense? Now, many people don't. What they do is they use the most slowest method. So you often see this in relationships where a woman will marry a man initially and the man's quite abusive and maybe even violent, right? So she works through that emotion where she doesn't want that anymore, and she releases that man from her life, and it's usually called divorce nowadays, but she releases that man from her life and she attracts another man. But this man is not physically abusive to her, but he's emotionally abusive to her. And she might live with him for another 10 years, hoping for him to change and so forth, like we always do, but eventually work through the emotion that causes her to stay in that condition. And if he doesn't change, she would probably leave that relationship. Now, she's learnt two things, hasn't she, about self-love. Self-love doesn't let me get abused physically. Then she, on the second marriage, learnt self-love doesn't let her get abused emotionally. So she's doing pretty good, right? But that might have taken 25 years. Do you want to take 25 years to learn those two lessons? Right? Really? Now, many of us have, haven't we? In our own lives, we have taken this long period of time to learn these lessons that are being reflected at us. Now, the law of attraction operating on your soul condition is God's messenger of truth to you. Now, if you're really serious about the law of attraction, can you see that the first time the lady got hit, she could have actually dealt with the emotion or the passion or desire or longing inside of her soul that created her soul condition? And she could have dealt with that emotion there and then, and the very next day left that relationship. Now, that often doesn't happen, does it? Often you stay in it for 10 years, but you can see how if she had a different way of dealing with it, she could have actually dealt with it and within a day or 2 days or a week be totally out of that relationship, no longer attracting it. Does that make sense? If she dealt with it emotionally. The problem with dealing with it intellectually, she says, I've been beaten up by this guy, so I leave him, I go to a refuge home, you know, spend a few weeks there, find another life. If I don't deal with it emotionally, what am I going to attract next? The same kind of man in a different body. That's what I'm going to attract. And then if we find that happening in our lives, what are we doing? We are basically not listening to God's messenger of truth. We're not listening to the law of attraction. Now, usually when a child isn't listened to, what happens? Often they speak a bit louder, right? And then they speak a bit louder. And then they yell and scream at you, right? Trying to get your attention. Isn't that right? Well, that's what the law of attraction does. Have many of you noticed that? How the law of attraction, you know, you could have listened to one thing, you could have listened to the next, and then it just intensifies until it feels like everything's caving in on you. And then you listen. Well, you don't have to do that either. You could listen the first time, you see. And this is why it's very important to understand the law of attraction, because if we understand it, we'll start seeing it as God's speaking to me. Do you follow me? And if we start seeing it as that, we will start listening to it. And we'll start observing it on a day-to-day basis. And if you start doing that, then the power of it gets exploded. It gets enhanced so much that every single day you are changing and every single week you start attracting different things because of the rapid changes you're making. So how do we make rapid changes? The first way to make rapid changes is, the only way to make the most rapid changes are to do with receiving divine love. Now remember, there is three principles of receiving divine love. Can you remember them? First one is desiring from God. Having a soul longing, which is, this is called prayer, right? So you can call that prayer. Having a soul longing for God's love to enter you. Right? Now what does that do? What that does is, firstly, it develops desire for love. Now, desire is a key aspect in regard of the law of attraction. And we'll talk about why. There's actually laws surrounding desire, and you don't really need to know them. All you need to do is exercise your desire. And what will happen is all the things you want start getting attracted to you more rapidly. So how many of you found, when you first listened to the DVDs that you were presented with, you know, regarding the secrets of the universe and everything, how many of you found within a week, all of a sudden, there were different big emotional things happening in your life? How many of you found that? so more than half the audience. That's because just that soul opening in your soul created this desire for truth and a desire for love. And as soon as that desire for truth and desire for love was created, what happened was your soul just kicked it up a notch. Right? And your law of attraction, because of the desire, just kicked up a notch as well. And you started attracting the things that would release the emotions that are causing the soul condition damage. So, desire for God's love. Next thing, remember, what was part of the divine path? Desire for truth. Now, remember I said before, divine truth? What's divine truth? Remember, that is God's truth. So, this is not you living in your truth anymore. This is you starting to see the truth about everything around you, including the truth about yourself, from God's perspective. And that's a lot different than seeing it from your own perspective. Right? So once that desire for God's truth comes along, that kicks up your law of attraction, desire for truth. Now, many of you have had a desire for truth for a lot of your life, right? And the truth is that around the world, there are literally hundreds of thousands or even millions of people who have a desire for truth. But a big problem that we have with truth is that we desire truth, and usually we don't understand that straight away, usually within a day or two, truth will come to us. So we desire this truth, the truth comes to us, and we say, no, that wasn't the truth, that can't be the truth. But it is that easy, actually. Right? The truth is that the more strongly you desire truth at your soul condition, the more strongly you will attract truth instantly into your life. But remember, truth is an emotional process. It's not an intellectual process. It's going to confront you intellectually. So how many of you have had a strong desire for truth, then you meet up with this guy, AJ, you know, who's saying he's Jesus and all this kind of thing, and it stressed you out to the max, right? How many of you felt that? Like lots of people, I know most of you. Anyway. And yet, it was your desire for truth that attracted me into your life. Like, I didn't come into your life because I decided I wanted to meet you. I came into your life because I could feel at the soul level your desire for truth. And that's what I respond to. Does that make sense? This is what's going on constantly. Now, as soon as you heard that I'm saying I'm Jesus, most people who hear that just walk away. Why is that? They attracted me, they get me, and then they walk away from me. Why is that? Because most of the time, you know, we don't know how to receive. We don't trust our law of attraction. We don't listen to what's really going on at the soul level. That's what's happening. We have preconceived ideas of truth. We have
beliefs.
Or beliefs that prevent us from actually listening to what's being presented to us. All the time. This goes on all the time. This is what's happening in your day-to-day life, even. In your day-to-day life, what's happening right now is many single times you are getting presented with the actual truth about your own emotional condition, and you resist it and say it can't be right, it must be somebody else's fault, they're to blame. Many times, be honest with yourselves, this is what is going on for your life, right? Right now. Why? Because we are quite resistive to seeing ourselves reflected back to us. That's why. So, the third thing. On the divine path, the third thing is always be humble. Be humble. Remember what I said be humble was? It's a passionate desire to feel your own emotions, to experience your own emotions. A passionate desire to experience your own emotions. Can you see how desire, passionate desire, you see how desire is working here? When you ramp up your desire, you ramp up your law of attraction. Very important principle of the law of attraction. So, those three things are your shortcut into actually clearing away your soul condition damage and receiving new truths. Those three things are your shortcut. Now, if you decide to not do those things, you can do it the slower ways. And those slower ways are exactly what I mentioned earlier. about the lady, you know, who had the relationship and then worked through one issue and then had another relationship and worked through the other issue. Can you see what's happening there? That's a slow way.
Is that the natural love path?
And that's the natural love path. The natural love path is a very, very slow path for most people because they're working through the law of attraction events in a slow manner, not realizing there is this fast way to work through things. Now, when I say fast, within a few years, you'll find yourself really clear if you're totally open on this path. Now, the problem is most people say, oh, I was totally open and, you know, it's been 5 years now and I'm still not there. Well, the truth is you weren't totally open. And there's a lot of resistance in us. And we'll get to resistance in a minute in this discussion, right? But this is the fast way for you to access your law of attraction. The slower ways are mentioned a bit lower in that section. And you notice how I've mentioned things like growing desires and passions harmonious with love. So that's a bit slower way, but it's something you can do. For example, you can nurture and grow within yourself the desires and passions that are harmonious with love, natural love, with your expression of love, and your law of attraction will change. You can do things like, down a bit further, I've said changing intellectual beliefs, thoughts and words and actions. You can do that if you like, and the majority of people on the natural love path do that. Change their thoughts. It takes a long time, though, for a thought to permeate into the soul. Unless we're very young, thoughts permeate into the soul when we're very young, very rapidly. Mostly because those thoughts are also associated with some pretty heavy emotional projections. And that's why they enter the soul so rapidly. So, for example, if you are 2 years of age and your parents become, say, Pentecostal Christians, your soul will feel that far more than if you were 20 years of age and your parents become Pentecostal Christians. Can you see the difference? One is you are very dependent on your emotions from your parents, and so you are absorbing their emotions. The other, you've probably got a bit more wide variety within yourself of emotions and experiences, and so it has less of an effect on you. So, the key thing to understand is that your thoughts can affect the law of attraction, just like it says in the secret. But it's going to be very, very weak influence. And that's why it's only successful for a few people. Does that make sense? The way to make it completely successful 100% of the time is to have it so that it's actually affecting your soul condition, which is your emotional condition. That's how you have it affect that. And we'll talk about how that happens in a minute. So can everyone see the importance of your soul condition in this? Now, why is soul condition important? Because God has a relationship with your soul. And the universe has a relationship with your soul. And every single person around you actually has a relationship with your soul. They don't have a relationship with your body. They don't have a relationship with your mind. They don't have a relationship even with your spirit body or your spirit body's mind. So for all of those spirits that are here, they don't have a relationship with any of those things. Every single being in the universe, including animals, including inanimate objects too, by the way, all have a relationship with your soul. God has a relationship with your soul. So, your soul condition is this thing of supreme importance. Not what you look like, and not what you think, but rather what's going on inside of yourself truly. That is the thing of supreme importance. Now, I've already had a lot of discussions about denial of the soul and how you can get away from your soul and all those kind of things. And I won't go into those things at this moment, except for mentioning a few things later. But please understand, the law of attraction is about refining your soul condition to one of two different states. One state is that you become perfect in natural love, or the other state is you become perfect in divine love. It will refine you to one of those two states. Now, one of those states, the natural love path, is dependent upon your desire to know yourself and to experience yourself fully. And in fact, on that path, remember, most people finish up saying they are God because they experience themselves that much, they feel they're so wonderful, that they become gods, right? They feel that way. That's the natural love path. And if you refine yourself in that manner using the law of attraction, your soul condition will be refined until the sixth sphere of the spirit world. If you go on the divine love path, where you're no longer gods, but God's child, and you develop these desires, what will happen is the law of attraction will refine you, and you'll actually enter the seventh sphere, the eighth sphere, and you will keep progressing everlastingly. There will be no actual stop to your progression on that path. So that applies to all of the spirits here as well. It doesn't matter where they are right now. They can be in the bottom of the first sphere, which is very hellish sort of conditions, and yet they can still change their soul condition. So all of us are totally capable of changing our soul condition. So does everyone understand soul condition? What I mean by soul condition? So when you read the Paget messages, and many of you have started to read them, right? When you read them, whenever it mentions the word soul condition, think about your own soul condition. Allow yourself to feel the emotions that are inside of your soul about all the different aspects of things that you are learning. Let yourself feel your soul condition. And you know what? All of us will be very tempted to deny our soul condition. Why do we want to do that?
It's confronting.
Because it's confronting. It's painful to see yourself as you truly are. Right? But remember, pain is always things that are happening in disharmony with love. So if I feel pain in confronting my own soul condition, I am already in judgment of my own soul condition. So I'm not encouraging you to judge your own soul condition. There's a difference between judging it and actually feeling it and knowing it, isn't there? One is actually condemning it, and the other one is just saying this is what it is. So how many of you have felt judged with things that I've said to you through the course of these things? Often you have, haven't you? Often you've felt judged. But I haven't felt a judgment emotion towards you. All I'm doing is stating the truth of the soul condition. But as soon as you go into judgment, you are now actually saying to yourself that that soul condition is bad and wrong and terrible. And then you start dumping more things upon yourself, right? You don't need to do that. So if your law of attraction is bringing you events right now into your life, and remember the law of attraction is God's messenger of truth to you. If your law of attraction is bringing to you negative events and situations and relationships in your life right now, instead of just saying, oh, I've listened to AJ today and oh, my soul condition must be terrible. Right? And then the next step generally from there is, aren't I a terrible person? Right? And then the next step generally from there is, God would never want me now, right? And I need to go into all of that emotionally if I want, because they are all emotions that will change my soul condition. But the truth is that seeing yourself truthfully doesn't mean that you need to judge it all like this. But you do need to respond to it. And often it's the emotional response to it, which is the judgment that we need to firstly deal with. So that's something to consider. So everyone's happy with soul condition? I'm going to leave soul condition right at the top there. Constant reminder of what is governing the law of attraction for you. In the first century, I said an illustration quite often about a man who was a very, very rich man. And what he used to do is he had so many properties and he had so much land and he had so many slaves and workers working for him. And what he would do, he'd spend his whole evenings just planning the next day of how he could grow this wealth. That's what he spent doing every single day. So he would come from his long days of work and his long days of organising and everything, and he would then be planning what he would do the next day, you know, what bigger and better thing he could achieve the next day from a material perspective. And the next day he decided he was going to build lots and lots of warehouses because he didn't trust the people he was selling his goods to anymore. He decided he wanted to make money out of that process as well, right? You know how things happen nowadays even, similar to the first century, how you would actually, you know, be the person who grows something and then you'd sell it to a person who's a buyer and then they would get all those goods together and sell it to them in what's called wholesale and resale, right? Or retail. Same kind of thing happened then. And so he wanted to become what you would now call a wholesale direct place, but he just wanted to have the prices up a bit. He wanted to make more funds. And so he built these big warehouses that he would store everything that he was producing in. And one night he came home and he was having a drink of alcohol, actually, a bit of wine, and looking in a lot of self-satisfaction at what was actually going on in his life. He was feeling that he was really achieving everything he had believed he wanted. And right there and then, he had a heart attack and died. Now, where will he arrive in the spirit world? Remember, there's spheres in the spirit world, right? Remember, we've talked about them. There's first sphere, second sphere, third sphere, so forth. And remember, they're all in different conditions of love. Remember, it's the love that determines what sphere you're in. And he was into just milking everything around him to get what he wants. Where will he arrive? In sphere number one. That's where he will arrive. So right at that moment, God immediately reflected, through the law of attraction, his true condition to himself. And this is the problem with our life a lot of times. A lot of times with our life, we ignore our soul condition while we're alive on earth. And it's only when we pass into the spirit world that we first become aware that our soul condition perhaps wasn't as good as what we believed it to be. Now, what would you do in that situation? Now, with what you know now, you could work with that, couldn't you? You could understand it. But imagine you didn't know that. Imagine you had lived your entire life in this way of just looking for material thing after material thing after material thing for satisfaction, constantly looking at what you can get yourself rather than what you can give and all of those kind of things, which are all the opposite of love. Love self, certainly, but not love of others. And you're getting all of those different things in. And then you're confronted just to order. Imagine the trauma of that. And many people who pass, and many spirits that are here with us today, are in that traumatized state. They feel, why are they where they are? Why are they in this dark place that's dingy and they haven't even got a pretty place to live in anymore and they want to come back to earth and, you know, they want to reincarnate. How do they reincarnate? I want to come back to earth. I don't want this dingy place I've got up here. Right? There's all these feelings and emotions they have. Because what happens in the spirit world is that God has created this set of laws that if you do things here on earth and you don't listen to your law of attraction here, your law of attraction ramps up in the spirit world. And one way it ramps up is the location where you live is a true reflection of your soul condition. And one of the reasons why I'm saying this now is because there are a lot of spirits here who don't know why they're in what's called the hills. And the reason why they don't know is they don't understand that it's the soul condition, the feelings inside of themselves, that are keeping them where they are. And all they need do is release those feelings and they will go to a new location. Isn't it far better to learn that here than there? Can you see why the truth here is so important? Because if you start living your life here, where you understand what your soul condition is and you understand what that generates in your life, when you pass, you will not receive any shocks. In fact, if you do receive a shock, it will be that you're shocked about how good it has been. because you've worked through the different things inside of your own soul condition. God is very generous with us. Right? When we pass, usually that's when we first find that out. You can find it out here, of course, but most people don't find it out here. They find it out when they pass. That God looks at all the things you've done where you've had a soul condition that is pure with far more weight than he does look at all the things with a soul condition that were impure. But it is your impure soul condition that creates your attractions, mostly the attractions that are negative, I'm saying, here on earth and in the spirit world. So, where your heart is where you are. Where your treasure is where your heart is. So what are you treasuring right now? Are you valuing your soul right now? Or are you valuing material things right now? Are you valuing your relationships in love right now? Or are you valuing what you can get from those relationships right now? Can you see how what you're valuing in your heart, what your treasure is where your heart will be and where your desire will be, and therefore where the law of attraction will be operating? It's very important to look at that, your desires and passions and longings. So, notice I've said there, under the law of attraction operates on the soul condition, that the soul condition determines how the law of attraction operates. And I'm drumming this into you. In disharmony with love, if you operate in disharmony with love, it is going to bring painful events into your life to correct you. If you operate in harmony with love, it will bring you many uplifting and joyful experiences in your life. So, one lesson of love that we'll talk about in 2 weeks' time is, if I am in pain, then something unloving is happening. Now, I'm not talking about the process of releasing emotional pain. I'm talking about the pain of what you would call suffering. Right? Pain is a great thing. The reason why it's a great thing is it tells you immediately, through your law of attraction, that something's wrong. Pain is a very good thing. Suffering is not a good thing. How many of you enjoy suffering? No. How many of you enjoy pain? No. But pain is actually a good thing. Because pain tells you when you break a law. Pain in your body tells you a law is being broken. Right now, if you have pain in any part of your body, a law is being broken. Right? A law of love is being broken if you have this pain. Now, it might be a law of love if it's down here. It might be a law of love revolving how you view yourself, how you view yourself in a relationship. If it's here, it might be regarding how you fear things still. You know, if it's here, it might be how you're holding on to sadness and not letting it go. It's all laws of love being broken. Your law of attraction is bringing you every pain in your body. Every single body pain, every single accident you have, every single disease you get and every single illness you have is all a result of your law of attraction. Every single positive experience you have, every single uplifting experience you're having, every single joyous and loving experience you're having is also all the result of your law of attraction. Can you see how it operates without partiality? There are good things inside of us and there are things that are evil inside of us. And those good things are attracting very positive events in our law of attraction, and the evil things are attracting very negative events in our law of attraction. And when I say evil, I'm saying disharmony with love. Alright? So, if I'm in pain, obviously, that's great. Listen to your pains, because your pains are telling you straight away, something's wrong. Right? So, even when I'm talking nowadays, I just, like, oh, there's a pain in my foot. What did I just say? What's going on? You know what I mean? So just let yourself feel what's going on emotionally. Let yourself be aware of what's happening. Which foot is it? Left-hand side. Women's stuff. Why am I feeling that? You know? Allow yourself to look at yourself in the mirror. Suffering is long-term pain. That's where we haven't listened for a long time. Now, that's really hard to overcome, because if you haven't listened for a long time, you've usually got a very, very good reason, right? That you feel you have a very good reason for not listening for such a long time. So it's going to be very tempting for you to not listen some more, isn't it? But understand that those two things are telling you, through your law of attraction, what's going on for you. Now, you notice in there too, I've said the most powerful way to change your soul condition is by receiving divine love. As divine love enters your soul changes, and every single untruth within it gets exposed. And remember, untruth is emotional untruth too. It'll come out as emotions, not as thought, but as emotion. All right. So, are we all okay with soul condition? So, most of us know a little diagram where we have our soul. So there's our half of the soul. So mine's a male half of the soul. So my body, disproportionate as usual. There's my spirit body. Physical body. Okay, and there's my soul, right? Now, what is the real me?
Soul.
Okay. And what is that again? My emotions, passions, desires, longings, beliefs, intentions. All those things that we mentioned earlier. Okay? So, if I go and get some therapy that actually deals with this, what am I ignoring? My soul. And what's my law of attraction operating? What? My soul. So I'm not saying don't deal with the spirit body or don't deal with the material body. But the majority of us, when we deal with those two things, we ignore our soul. And it's the soul's emotions that actually create all the illnesses in these bodies and all the problems with those bodies and all the attractions of those bodies. So if I'm just going to deal with these two things, all I'm dealing with is the effect of the soul's causal condition. The soul is the cause, and these are the effects. Now, I'm saying this because in the spirit world at the moment, quite a number of the spirits have come. And one of the questions that's in a lot of their minds is this question, why do I look so bad? See, on Earth, they look pretty good, many of them. You know, you imagine on Earth, you're quite a well-off person, say, on Earth. You know, you can get a bit of a tummy tuck here and there and a bit of Botox on the face. And you can keep yourself looking quite good for a long time if you want, right? And you can look in the mirror and see things are not so bad. But you could be a person who has some really terrible desires in you, disharmonious with love. And actually what you will look like from God's perspective is terribly emancipated, like, you know, this terrible looking face that you can even barely recognize. So if you could look at your spirit body in the mirror, which eventually all of us will be able to do, and in fact God allows us to do this, but we've become so afraid of our spirit body because it looks so bad that we've all turned it all off, right? But the truth is that we can look at the spirit body and see our soul's true condition. And sorry?
It's like the movie The Picture of Dorian Gray.
Yes. Yeah.
The portrait became ugly
as his soul condition changed.
Yes.
The Dorian Gray movie. Is there a movie of that? Is there?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. And perhaps we could just have the mics because it's important. Fire away. Switch on.
The volume down the slide.
Quite near, please. Thank you. Far away.
My question is to do with the spirit body. And when
I understand the distinction between the physical body work and the soul and the spirit body. What I don't understand is when you talk about working on the spirit body.
Well, you know, when a person maybe lays you down on the table and does some chakra work, for example. So whenever you're working with the chakras, you're actually working with your spirit body, not actually working with the material body. So, you know, if you go to along to a spiritual healer, how many of you have done that? Gone along to a spiritual healer and they've done some things over your spirit body, they've actually drawn some what they would call energy work. Very much spirit body work. Yeah, so that's what I mean by that. Now, there's no harm in that, in that it can relieve symptoms. Does that make sense? All of those things can relieve symptoms. But your law of attraction is operating on your
soul.
You relieve the symptom, and what do you think? Oh, I've cured the problem. But have you? No, because the soul needs to change. Can you see? And this is why often we go and get some kind of remedial therapy. We feel good for a week, and then what happens? Same thing happens again. How many of you visit a chiropractor every single month for the last 15 years, you know? Why do we do that? Because we're getting the physical body ingested, right? Getting a remedy, the problem in our physical body, but that's being created by the soul condition. And I'm not adjusting my soul condition, and so I'm needing to do it every week. Can you see the problem with this? Jenny, please.
Graham and I, during the week, have had hundreds and hundreds of faceless spirits who have no identity and have a difficulty with identity. We've lost or don't know anymore their, not only who they are or where they are,
yeah,
but have no form.
Yeah. What's actually happened with them is they've had some beliefs on earth that they could avoid the truth, and they're still in this emotional state where they feel that they can avoid truth, and so they're actually avoiding seeing themselves. So the truth is they do actually have form, and they could actually look at themselves, but they're so afraid of doing that, they don't want to do that. And so they create this state where they don't even want to see themselves. And it's like they're invisible even to themselves. And you can do that in the spirit world.
And the other thing I wanted to say is that when you go to a therapist, doesn't that in fact put your faith, if you like, in the person and the person's beliefs and things that aren't of God, when we could go to God directly and that would give us the real answer, the real beliefs, the
yeah,
real truth?
True, Jenny. A lot of times going through a therapist doesn't mean we're automatically putting faith in the therapist, though. We may, like, I'm not decrying you getting relief from your physical symptoms. Do you understand?
Mm-hmm.
So many of us have physical symptoms for different illnesses and so forth. Get relief for them if you feel you need them. But don't think you've cured them. Because the way to cure them is to cure the soul condition that created them. Does that make sense? So you need to start working on the soul condition that created these conditions. Dennis, have a go.
Okay. Going to a therapist as an initial step so that you can see where you're heading, is that... And then bringing it up?
Anything that lets you access this soul, do. Do you understand what I mean by that? Anything that you can choose to do in your life now that is going to access your soul, access your emotions, that's going to help you open up emotionally, do it. So it doesn't matter what it is. If it's going to a church, going to a therapist, going to wherever, do it, because it's going to open you up at the soul level. Have that focus first. If you're going there just to feel relief from physical body or spirit body pains, if you're doing it just for that, then you are doing it with the wrong focus. And it's going to be a continual thing you'll have to do over and over again. If you do it with a focus of looking at the soul, because remember, it's our soul condition that our law of attraction is operating upon. All of your physical illnesses are operating upon your soul's condition. So you can go and get relief for physical symptoms if you wish, but if your desire is just to get the relief, rather than to look at what soul condition created this pain, then straight away you're doing it with a motive that ignores the law of attraction. Can everyone see that? It's really important to see that. Can we deal with perhaps a lot of these questions a bit later? Because we will have a whole section on questions later. I want to, there's a fair bit of material to cover still, that's all. And I've only got 1 hour now to do it. Does everyone understand, though, how if you focus on your soul, that is your most powerful tool to actually change yourself? But if you focus on the physical body or the spirit body even, and this applies to the spirits that are here too, if you focus on those things rather than the soul, then what will happen is you are going to struggle with regard to this law of attraction. You're going to struggle, and you'll struggle, and you'll struggle, and you'll struggle, and eventually you'll feel so overwhelmed by the struggle that you'll just feel like giving up, right? Okay. Now, many of you are finding this intense emotional roller coaster that you've been going through since you've known me a bit of a struggle. But it is a much, much shorter struggle than what you would have had to have done if you did it any other way. Particularly if we talk about the stuff that we'll be covering in the next sections. Right.
AJ, imagine if you're in the spirit world and you didn't even know you had a soul.
Well, that's what the condition, the ones that Jenny just mentioned earlier, they don't even know they have a soul, they don't even know they have a form, and they don't know why they are where they are. It's a very, very difficult condition to get out from. It's far better to know all of this now than it is to know it much later on, certainly. Let's just look briefly, though, at the scope of the law of attraction.
Can I just ask you, just before we do that?
I asked for questions to be later.
Well, it was because of the soul and the spirit.
But I did ask for questions to be later. So why, what's the law of attraction there? I've said very plainly what I've asked for, and yet I'm still getting some interruptions. What's the law of attraction? What's my law of attraction? There's something in me that gives out the feeling that I'm going to let you get away with not doing what I've asked, isn't there? And there's something within you that feels like you can get away with not doing what I've asked. So look at those law of attractions. Sorry about that, but it's just something I had to mention. So feel the anger now too. All right, now over the page, you notice I've said other law of attraction points to remember. Now what I would like, this is where I'd like a bit of participation now, so don't be shy. I would like different people to just read out the one section. Each one of them is indented, so if you want to read out what each one is, and we'll talk about what each one is with regard to that. Who would like to do that first? No one, because they just got told off. Fire away. Including the example with the first one. So see how...
The law of attraction will operate in such a manner as to intensify the soul condition that drives it. Example, if we have murderous emotions, we will attract people, spirits and situations that seem to intensify those emotions until we become conscious of their existence and have a desire to experience the underlying causes. When we experience the underlying causes, the soul condition changes, and the law of attraction operates on the new soul condition.
So does everyone get that? So here's our soul. Here's mine. My soul has a certain law of attraction operating upon it. Does that make sense? It has a certain law of attraction operating on it. And what that law of attraction is doing is it's going out to the universe, and every single thing that I'm feeling is going to be attracted, even from spirits as well. So many of you over our discussions over the last year have been afraid about your spirit interactions. You've been afraid about attracting spirits who are negative in your life. You've been afraid about what they might do to you. You've been afraid about what they're already doing to you, some of you. Does that make sense? But you don't need to be afraid about all those things, because the way the law of attraction operates on your soul condition is that it operates to intensify the emotions until you're willing to experience them. Does that make sense? when you're willing to experience it, then you'll find your law of attraction will change. Then another set of conditions are experienced. Now, what happens with the spirits around you at that point is they will leave you if they're not attracted to you anymore. Or they will change because they've noticed you change. But either way, your life will be totally different. So, for example, many physical ailments are caused by spirit obsession. Do you know what I mean by that? What I mean is that even from a young age, many of our illnesses are actually caused by an attachment with a spirit who has that, or who believes they have, that illness. Right? And much childhood things like leukemia, childhood leukemia, for example, is a definite spirit attachment on that child. How do we change it? We change it as a parent by changing our soul condition. When we change our soul condition protects our child, and they'll have the spirit will leave them and find somebody else perhaps, but they'll leave our child alone. So our soul condition attracts even spirits around us, and it's all attracting it to intensify or make your emotions so strong that eventually you deal with it emotionally. That's why it happens. So every time you intellectually skip over it, what are you really doing? You're really saying, I'm not going to deal with that emotionally. And you are actually setting up a more intense lesson, probably, for a later time down the track. And if you want to do that, go ahead. It's not very enjoyable, though, is it? Many of you have done that in your lives, haven't you? And not found that very enjoyable. What's the next one? Someone like to just read that out for me?
The law of attraction.
The law of attraction represents the free will at the soul level of the individual.
Yes. Now, do you understand what that means? It means that the free will, remember, this soul has its own free will. Now, many people say to me that, you know, when they have a spirit attached to them, they say, I don't want this spirit hanging around me. This spirit's bothering me. It's really causing lots of havoc in my life. I don't want this spirit. And the first thing I say back to them is, yes, you do. Because the law of attraction is operating on your soul condition, and your soul's free will is what's being exercised, not what your intellect is saying, but what your soul is saying. And so it's your soul that's saying you want this spirit with you. And you want it because you're ramping up your law of attraction so that you deal with the emotion that this spirit with you creates. So let's say the spirit with you creates a fear-based emotion. Well, that's because you have fear within you about spirits that you need to let go of. Let yourself let go of it. Let yourself experience it emotionally and let go of it. Can you see how the soul condition operates upon your free will at the soul level, not what you think you're exercising your free will to be? Because remember, free will isn't about what you think. It's about what you feel. It's about what your emotional condition, your soul condition is. What's the next one? Someone like to read that one out for me? Don't be shy.
The law of attraction is impartial in its operation, never ceases to operate, and works on the soul condition.
Yeah. Now let's sit. So here's our soul condition. Firstly, our soul condition doesn't change whether we're asleep or awake. Does it? It just is what it is. So therefore, the law of attraction is operating upon our soul condition at every single moment. Right? So if you change your soul condition right at this moment, the very next moment, you'll get a different attraction. Does that make sense? Automatically. But also, the law of attraction is not partial. What I mean by that is, it doesn't operate on Joe Blow differently than what it operates on you if you had the same emotion. So if I say, yeah, I seem to just be an unlucky fellow. I was talking to my father the other day, My father's had so many accidents, like, he just is, you would call him accident prone. And my uncle, one of my uncles is even worse. You would call him, like, nine live accident prone. You know, he's just so accident prone. Now, I am not accident prone. My soul is attracting accidents for some reason. Right? There's an emotion inside of me that causes this attraction. The key is for me to feel the emotion. We'll talk about how to go into the emotion in a minute. The key is for me to feel the emotion that's creating that. What's the next point? Fire away. Don't think.
The law of attraction is always exact and never fails. It's always accurate, either in the spirit world or in the
matter. Right. This is very important also to understand. You didn't, Carol, last week, 2 weeks ago, you didn't get 3 fines for no reason. Right? The law of attraction is accurate and just operates perfectly every single time. It's very important to understand that with all of our lives. Everything, single thing we're attracting right now, the law of attracting is accurate right down to the minutest detail. Even down to stubbing your toe when you get out of bed in the morning, it's really accurate, right? Even down to every single cut you make when you're cutting up the veggies on your body, it's really accurate. Where it is will even be accurate. In terms of what emotion is and what kind of thing it's related to will be accurate. Everything about it is accurate. It's exact. It's an exact science if we know what it's doing. Very important to understand. What's the next one? Tris?
The law of attraction causes the most relative harmony to exist in any location on earth or in the spirit world.
Does that make sense to everyone what the term relative harmony means?
Yeah.
All right. Now, on earth, we don't experience a lot of relative harmony in the same degree that we would in the spirit world. But let me illustrate it in the spirit world, and then you'll see how it applies on earth. In the spirit world, all the people who have a certain condition of love all reside in the same place. So if you were murderous here on earth, and I'm not saying that you actually murdered, I mean if you had a murderous emotions in you on earth, you'll be attracted to a place in the spirit world when you pass where all the murderous people go. So all of your neighbours will be murderous. All of your friends, if we could call them friends, will be murderous. Because they'll all be attracted to the same location. Does that make sense? So what the reason why that is the case is it's constructing harmony. Can you see why that's harmonious? Because obviously if there was a group of murderers with a group of people who were quite kind and considerate, what would the murderers be doing? Murdering all those people. And in the end, what would be left is all the murderers. And so therefore, it is the most harmony. And so this is the thing to understand about the law of attraction. It's always creating the most harmony. It's creating everything based upon love. And so while we sometimes think of it as not very loving law, and we often become afraid of it, it's actually creating the most harmony in our lives. It's very, very harmonious. All right, what's next? I'll say it. The law of attraction causes our joys to be increased. And I use joys in quotation marks. Because if you enjoy murdering, then your law of attraction will cause your joy to be increased. You will have more opportunities to murder. There's an example in the pageant messages of a lady who had this emotion overcome her. This was in the late 1800s. She had an emotion overcome her. Where she wanted to murder people. She felt so angry and she just wanted to murder people. The way she was a nurse in a hospital. And she actually admitted to murdering hundreds of people in this hospital. She never got caught her entire life on earth. And her law of attraction allowed her to be in that place because it was the place that actually was most harmonious with her desire to do what she wanted to do, which was to murder and not get caught. Now, of course, when she passed in the spirit world, she began to see her condition. And she was in a terrible, torturous condition in the spirit world because of her choices. Can you see, though, the law of attraction will expose your joys, even if your joys are disharmonious with love. So if you have a desire in you, for example, to have as much sex as possible, right, then what will happen is your law of attraction, if it's a real desire within you, your law of attraction will attract as much sex as possible into your life. Now, of course, it won't be very helpful to your soul condition. In fact, it will probably make your soul condition much worse than it currently is now.
Depends who you're having sex with.
that's another discussion. I'm saying if you're having sex with lots of different people. I should clarify. Having lots of sex with one person is fantastic. And I won't go into that either. Alright, so the key thing is to focus on what's happening with the law of attraction. It will enhance your joys. What's next? Down, oh yeah. Just got it under organized.
The law of attraction determines that soul conditions attract emotions and thoughts. These come from either ourselves or from outside of ourselves.
Now that will do for the moment. What I'm saying there is that sometimes you have thoughts just drop into your mind. You notice that? Well, a lot of times it's the spirit actually dropping that thought into your mind. Now, why did that spirit drop that thought? That thought might be, my kids are going to die today. Or that thought might be, you know, wanting to kill somebody. Or that thought might be, why don't I cut my wrists? Or, you know, stuff that feels very foreign to you. So-called. The truth is, when we have these thoughts drop in our mind, we need to look at them because they are our law of attraction. There is something in that thought that dropped into our mind that was drawn to us by our own emotional or soul condition. Allow yourself to feel about it. Right? Now, sometimes you'll get so scared about some of these thoughts that you'll just want to run from them. But they are very powerful ways of telling you what's going on inside of yourself that you're not aware of. So if you have a thought just dropping in your mind, you want to have sex with that person, and it's not your partner, allow yourself to feel about it. Do you follow me? Allow yourself to feel. What attracted this thought into here? Let yourself feel about these things, because there's a soul condition that's attracting them into you. Let yourself acknowledge that. Now, I don't want to spend too much time on that section because the next section is really important. Because what we're interested in doing really is changing our soul condition, isn't it? Can you see that? We want to, on one hand, get rid of all the emotions that are disharmonious with love, because the soul condition with the stuff that's disharmonious with love causes all the painful experiences. So if he wants to get rid of all the painful experiences out of their life, that'd be fantastic, wouldn't it? On the other hand, so we go down this way, where we want to get rid of the pain, right? The other way is we want to enhance the pleasure, do we not? Yeah? Would everyone agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. So, if that's what we want to do, then we want to focus on those two facets of the law of attraction. We want to focus on what gets rid of the pain, and we want to focus on what actually enhances the pleasure. And that's what we want to discuss now. The emotions that are disharmonious with love, the beliefs, the passions, the desires, and the thoughts, the feelings, all the things, the aspirations, the intentions that are all disharmonious with love, are the things causing our pain. And all of the things that are harmonious with love, all of the thoughts, and then underneath all of that, the emotions, the passions, the desires, the intentions, the aspirations that are harmonious with love all cause the pleasure. Now, if we enhance that even one level further, if I say all the things harmonious with divine love, So this is the disharmony with divine love, and this is the harmony with divine love, causes the bliss or the agony. Okay. If we know that, we can start working with that on two sides. And this is where we need to begin developing our soul in two areas. One area is releasing the error. So the pain is synonymous with the error. And the other is accepting the truth. You follow me? So, I'm here with my soul condition. My soul condition contains all of these emotions, of which some are error-based emotions, which are causing all of my pains, and others are pleasure-based emotions, which are caused by the truth that I already know. And all of us have this within us. There are truths that we have, and there's errors that we have. And if I look at it from a point of view of divine love, then I'm looking at it from God's perspective, not just from a natural love or a personal love perspective. Now when I start developing that, I realize that obviously the biggest thing that's going to affect both conditions is this thing called prayer. Remember what I'm always saying prayer is. Prayer is developing a desire or longing within your soul for God's love to enter you. Now, you can also pray to God about other things other than God's love, just by developing a desire or longing within yourself to know about those other things. And what will be some of the things you might want to know about if you were progressing with the law of attraction? You might want to know, truthfully know, what are causing your pains. Your physical pains, your emotional pains. And so you talk to God about that. Talk to God about, be honest about your pains. Be honest about the things that are causing you pain in your life with God. And the same goes with your pleasures. Talk to God about those. How you can enhance it. What within you. A lot of times we don't even know what within us created that pleasure. Like, so I've heard some people come up and say, you know, I've got a wonderful husband, but I've got no idea how I attracted him. Right? Well, it would be good to know why you're attracted to him, wouldn't it? Don't you think? What inside of you caused that? And so this is about praying about the truth, becoming aware of what's going on inside of you that created that pleasurable experience as well. Because if we want to enhance the pleasure, it's great to know how we did that. And if we want to actually remove the pain, it's great to know how we do that. This is what we need to do. So, if we look at it, the law of attraction is really great at exposing all of these different things. Now, how does that work? Well, here's you. This is me, I'm a blockhead, so square. SC means soul condition. So this is AJ's soul condition. Now, what we do with our soul condition usually is we build a great big castle around it. With great big towers for protection, right, all around our soul condition. And then we put a big moat around it, right, maybe that should be in blue. And then we have all of these things around it, which are all very prickly spikes around it as well. Right? Can you see what we're doing? We're creating our defences for our castle. And our castle is what God doesn't want us to have. But we started creating these defences from a very, very young age. We were taught to do this, usually by our parents, but certainly by our environment. So here's our real soul condition, sitting in the middle. God wants to interact with my soul. To do that, what's God going to have to do? Bar through all these defences. So let's imagine there's this army and they're coming to attack our castle for a moment. What will you do when an army attacks you? Okay, yeah, so there's one thing you want to do is defend. So whenever you step into defense, often you're stepping into resistance of actually the law of attraction working on your benefit. Can you see how often we're opposing the law of attraction in our own actions? Yeah. Now, what else do we normally do? So we defend the castle. What's the best form of defense?
Attack.
Ah, yeah. We're good at that too, are we not? We attack. We go on to the attack. Attack the marauding army that's coming in. What God wants us to do is to actually be free to have this army just come and invade us. But can you see emotionally, that's quite a vulnerable state, isn't it? Can you see that? Not, how many of us want to be vulnerable? Not many initially, do we? We're so much trying to keep everybody at a distance, to keep this soul condition, to keep our emotions, to keep ourself protected. We see that as our self. So this is our, you could say, in here is our soul, our real self, and we're trying to protect it at all costs. But when we have that attitude, we're actually working in disharmony with the law of attraction. Because the law of attraction is that God doesn't want you to defend anything. God doesn't ever want you to go on the attack. Do you think love defends? Do you think love attacks? In the end, love just is, isn't it? It doesn't need to defend and it doesn't need to attack. Right? So in the end, we will want to stay in harmony with truth ourselves, but and obviously we want to support whatever the truth is, but we can stay firm with that without defending and or going on the attack. What God wants us to do emotionally is to open up all of these barriers. Right, so let's put it in a practical situation. I'm married. I have a mother-in-law. How many of you are mother-in-laws? More than that. Nobody wants to own up to being a mother-in-law. Why? Because she's a maligned person. And she is often a maligned person. And the reason why is that she's often thought of as the army. So let's call her the mother-in-law. And this man is married, who's married. Every time his mother-in-law comes, he always finishes up having an argument with her or his wife about something. Right? What's happening when he argues? He's defending or going on the attack of it for his castle, isn't he? What does God want him to do? Just let this person into his life. The law of attraction is operating. The law of attraction brought this mother-in-law into his life, right? To actually help him access an emotion within himself. And he needs to allow that emotion to be triggered. So let's say the emotion is that every time she comes, she just treats him like dirt. And then when he leaves, she gets into his wife about, you know, your mum just treats me like dirt every time she's here. I hate her, you know? What's the emotion in him? He's got some kind of unworthiness inside of him, isn't he? That's attracting somebody who wants to treat him like he's unworthy. And the mother-in-law is just fitting the bill nicely. Because she might have emotions of anger with men, for example, right? And so she's angry with him and always happens every time he comes. Now, if he just allowed her to go through all of his defences and actually trigger the soul condition, which will be some grief, right? She'll trigger some grief about how he's feeling about himself. And he just cried in front of her, which is probably the opposite thing that he wants to do, right? What does he want to do instead? Yell and scream and get her to go. But if he just did the opposite of that, he would probably connect with a causal emotion regarding his own mother. And he'd probably release that. And if he released that, he would no longer even attract her doing it. And she might be exactly the same person, you know, and she might have exactly the same anger emotion within her, but because his soul condition has changed, she will never treat him the same way again. And so then the mother-in-law will be a nice person to him instead of being what he's afraid of. He's afraid of dealing with his own emotion of grief. And she is the perfect trigger for that thing. Now, of course, I'm not justifying her emotions. Her emotions are probably one of anger with men, right? And if she allows his anger to trigger her, she might deal with her emotion too. Can you see how the law of attraction is operating for both of them? To help each of them deal with what's going on? Very important to understand. So, what do you do when your castle is attacked?
Drop the drawbridge.
Open it up. Let it all go. This is what we finish up doing. The first thing we do generally is we resonate with what's going on. So, the man with the mother-in-law. The mother-in-law comes and treats him like he's a bastard. Right? Because she has that emotion in her that men are bastards. So she treats him like one, right? So she treats him in that manner. And, you know, if he didn't have the emotion in himself that something about himself is bad, he would never resonate with it. Does that make sense? And if he didn't resonate with it, he wouldn't even feel anything. He'd just feel love for her, wouldn't he? Say, oh, there she goes again, treating men like bastards, but doesn't worry me, I'm not a bastard. Now, it can only be an emotion inside of himself that starts resonating with it, doesn't it? And this is what happens to us all. If the emotion is in us, it resonates. It's like a singer when the opera singer, when they sing a high note, and the window panes or something vibrate or the glasses explode. You've heard of that, right? That's called resonant frequency. And you could think of every emotion within you as has a resonant frequency with a sympathetic emotion outside of you, right? And when that sympathetic emotion outside of you is attracted to you through the law of attraction, this resonant thing goes off inside of you and you respond. So what do you do then? Well, generally what we do is we step into projection. And the way we project, generally, we go into anger. Or we withdraw. Withdraw. Or we love it away. Every one of those is an avoidance. There's many others, by the way. I've only listed three very popular ones. The most popular two are generally these two. Now, I classify anger as annoyance, mild annoyance, a little bit frustrated. These are all anger-based responses, right? So that's all in anger. Withdrawal is, oh, I'm gone quiet now, right? I'm stepping back from this transaction. I don't want to be involved in this transaction. That's withdrawal. The problem with these steps that we take is that we are now out of living in the power of the law of attraction. Can you see that? If the law of attraction is operated to bring this event into my life, I'm resonating with it. It's great. At that point, this is great. I'm resonating with it. So I'm now in this state where I'm now conscious of what something inside of me is that's in disharmony with love. I'm resonating with it. That's fantastic. What's your next choice? That's the key. Most of the time, our next choice is to go into that. Into actually rejecting what the law of attraction is bringing to me. That's our next choice. Do you want to keep making that choice? So if you keep making that choice, this resonance is going to have to happen again. And again, until we stop making that choice and get into a non-projecting way, which is actually a feeling way, where I'm accepting my own emotions. Does that make sense to everyone? Now, these are really good keys to you. They're telling you, oh, I'm angry, I'm no longer respecting my own law of attraction. I'm no longer listening to God. I am no longer listening to the messenger of truth. As soon as I'm in that state. Does that make sense? As soon as I'm in that state, I'm no longer listening anymore. Right? As soon as I'm in this state, I'm no longer listening anymore to my law of attraction. As soon as I'm in this state, now what's this state? This is like a state where, you know, somebody starts crying around you. So what you do is you run up to them and give them a hug. There you go. It's not that bad. You know? What are you doing? They've just resonated. They're just in their emotion. And what are you trying to do? You're trying to suppress it. Why are you trying to suppress it? Because there's an emotion in you that's resonating with their resonant emotion. Right? If they're crying, your feelings and grief you do not want to feel. And you're trying to calm them down. You're trying to love them away. And it's not loving. It's in fact the opposite of love. It's actually very harmful and damaging. Because you're making out to yourself it's love. It's even the more damaging thing. It's better to just see it as I'm just trying to calm them down than it is to see it as loving. Because it's not loving. If we can leave the questions to after still. So, what often we do, and there's lots of other projection type emotions we use, blame, judgment, and so forth. All these other projection style emotions we continue to use because we feel the resonance and then we get frightened. And when we get frightened, what do? We then step away from actually feeling the emotion and we go into this place where we want to make everybody else around me to blame for the emotion. When right at the start, what did we say the law of attraction was? We are getting what we really want. Right at that moment, I am getting what I really want. What I really need at the soul level is coming to me at that moment. And I need to let it happen. I need to actually allow the trigger to occur. So there are so many emotions that you'll feel in this projection phase. Anger, blame, frustration, guilt. A lot of these different emotions are actually your avoidance of the underlying causal emotion. So when I say the causal emotion, that's the emotion that's causing the attraction. Do you follow me? So when we talk about causal emotions, we're talking about the emotions that actually cause the attraction. And if we focus on allowing the trigger, so we usually have an event which triggers us emotionally. So I might be driving along the road, I've used this example hundreds of times, right? Somebody cuts us off. Trigger emotion, fear. Trigger emotion into anger. When I'm in anger, what did I just do? I just skipped through the resonance and I'm now in the projection on the denial. And that happens. That can happen in 1 second. How many times has that happened to you in 1 second? You haven't even been conscious of all of that going on in your soul. Your soul is so fast at processing everything. A lot of times you don't even know it's happened by the time it's happened. Right? Now when we get these triggers, allow them to actually affect you emotionally. Stop intellectualizing them away. Stop avoiding them. Allow them to feel them. So if let's say the trigger is, right at this point, a man treated me like I was unworthy to be heard. So that's my trigger. That's the trigger for an emotion that's inside of me of unworthy to be heard by a man. Right? Because if it's a man, if it's a woman, then it's unworthy to be heard by a woman, right? So, allow yourself to feel that emotion, then step into that emotion. I'm stepping into that emotion, and now I'm starting to feel some feelings from my childhood. Where my father or a major male in my life constantly projected that at me, where that I was unworthy to be heard because I was a girl. Right? Now I'm feeling my causal emotion. So my trigger exposes the emotion, and I can step into that emotion and start feeling it. And as a result of that, I can take the next step, which is always related to somewhere in my childhood generally, where I can feel the actual causal emotion. And it's the causal emotion that caused the attraction. So if I release the causal emotion, what will happen to my future attractions? They will just disappear. Does that make sense? That's how you make them disappear. Okay. And I've got a quarter of an hour. And I want to go into the next section, actually. Oh, one thing I need to say. Under that section, when the law of attraction events happen, I say, look at your personal reasoning. If you're saying, and many of you have done this with me in your private discussions, if you're saying to yourself, he did that to me, or she did that to me, or this happened to me, you are actually not respecting the law of attraction. If you respect the law of attraction, your own internal feelings will be, I attracted this event. You will always go there. So you won't say, he was a bastard, you know, he did that to me, and he did this to me, and he did that to me. You won't be saying those things anymore, because you will instead be saying, I attracted a man into my life who did this to me. I attracted a man into my life who did that to me. What inside of me caused that attraction? That's what you'll start saying. And that's a very powerful place to be, because who is the only person you can change?
Yourself.
And when you change yourself, ironically, people around you start changing too. Right? And that's because your law of attraction changes when you change yourself. And you're changing your soul condition. That's when your law of attraction changes. Now, you can also use this law in a very positive way. So I've talked so far in how to use it in a negative way. And so when I say negative, how to actually explore your painful emotions. Does that make sense? So it's the painful emotions that often cause us to not be in bliss or in happiness, isn't it? So you can use the law of attraction to explore your painful emotions in that way. How can you use your law of attraction to explore your pleasurable emotions? And that's what the last section is that I want to focus on. You've heard all heard the statement, I think they said it in The Secret, you know, that you are the creator of your own destiny. That is a truth. That is actually a divine truth. But it's your soul condition that creates your destiny. So if you change your soul condition, you are changing all the future events. It's like dropping a pebble in a pond. You know, when you drop the pebble in the pond, the pebble just doesn't hit the water and then go to the ground and nothing else happens, does it? What happens is you get these ripples going out right to the edge of the pond, and the pebble might have only been tiny, and yet the ripples are felt right at the edge, right? And it's the same with your life. Every single tiny thing that you change in your life at the soul level is like a new pebble being dropped into the pond. And your whole attraction will change as a result of that. Everything will change if you allow it. But these are not intellectual pebbles. These are feelings, passions, desires. So how do we develop it? Well, step one, what does it say? To develop or grow your soul desires harmonious with love. Sorry about that. Now, in The Secret, they suggest that is the process of asking. So in other words, when you ask, often it was said, and again it's a quote from what I said in the first century, and that is, if you ask, you shall receive. But see, again, most people don't understand that. It's what you ask for at the soul level. So it's the soul condition that's asking. Right? So if I can be more specific, it's actually developing or growing your soul desires that is causing the asking. Now, you can develop or grow your soul desires in a completely negative way, can't you? Like, you can develop your soul desires to become a murderer and really become quite good at it. Right? There's been people in history that have done that, and they've murdered millions of people as a result of their desire. Right? That's not what I'm suggesting, because that's not going to bring you happiness. Right? What's going to bring you happiness is when you grow the soul desires that are harmonious with love. And if we want to even be more expressive, the ones that are harmonious with divine love are going to even be greater in their power and their blessings and their bliss than the ones in harmony with natural love. So you can develop your desires there. That's step one. So is a desire to have a good relationship with your partner a harmonious with love desire? Well, it could be. It might not be, because you might do it using methods that are untruthful. So I'm not suggesting you do that either. In other words, you might not tell your soul, your partner the truth, and that's how you have a good relationship. Because he's only hearing good things about himself, and he never hears anything that is in error about himself. And so I'm not suggesting that either. I'm suggesting that the stuff that's going to bring you the most bliss in your life is when you are going to do this harmonious with love and truth. Alright? And you know, it's the end truth that most of us have problems with, isn't it? We're happy when we think about love. When we think about truth, we often become quite unhappy, because often we don't even know what the truth is, or we do know what the truth is, but we're afraid to say it. But honestly, if you develop and grow the soul desires harmonious with those things, what will happen is your life will change very rapidly to becoming a blissful and happy life. You will go through lots of emotions in the process, very rapidly, if you do that. Right? What's the next step? Step two? Let's just call it, have faith that it's going to happen. Trust that it's going to happen. Have faith. Having faith is very interesting. You can create faith as well, by the way. Now let me put it in a really probably crass illustration, but let's say for a moment, some of you guys here, how many of you would love to have a sports car in your life? A few of you? Yes. I was one of those, by the way. I didn't have one. So I can't, this is why it appeals to me. Imagine for a moment that you would like to get a new Lamborghini Gallardo. Does anyone know what that looks like?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, not a lot of people know. But imagine that. Now, I'm not suggesting that's harmonious with divine love, because the truth is it isn't harmonious with divine love. A car pollutes, so straight away it's not harmonious with divine love, right? But anyway, let's say it's harmonious with my desire, and I can lose my law of attraction in this manner. So I desire this vehicle. How can I build my desire? Well, I could actually start thinking about myself driving the car, couldn't I? I could even more powerfully go to a place where I could test drive the car and actually sit in the car. Can you see how the more emotional things I do, the greater my desire is going to become? Now let's look at some desires harmonious with love. One of them, I know many of you are thinking you want to teach these truths to others, right? So many of you are afraid of that. But if you exercise your desire harmonious with love, you will want to teach, probably. So start picturing yourself teaching for a moment and allow yourself to work through some of those emotions that cause you to feel afraid of that. Then actually put yourself in a position where you get 10 people in front of yourself and you start telling them the truth and see what happens. Let the law of attraction bring you and refine you in this manner to actually grow this desire. Do you follow me? Allow yourself to follow that. Another desire you might have might be to actually create an environment where people can come to deal with their emotions. So start growing that desire. You might not have any money to do it. And the truth is you don't need any. Because, you know, God's laws don't operate around money. Do we get that? Well, it's money, a piece of paper that man's created for man's economic system. God's laws don't operate around them. So the truth is that if you have a soul desire to do something, you don't need money to begin it. You just need the desire. And when the desire comes, everything else that you need, and if money is one of those things you need, that will also come. Does that make sense to everyone? This is how faith works. Have faith that this is going to occur. But the third thing you need to do is, and that's the same as what the secret says, is to allow I before E except after C. Allow yourself to receive. You know, one of the biggest problems that we have is that we ask for something, we feel like we believe we're going to get it, the very next day it's offered to us in a completely foreign form that we would ever normally allow ourselves to receive. And so what do? We reject it. And God just went, oh, doesn't she know that I've given her everything she wants right now, right? And yet often this is what happens, right? And the reason why is often what God gives us is not in the guise, in the outward appearance of what we think it should be. So, you know, you may be asking for some truth and you may think you're going to get it from me, but in reality, tomorrow, your three-year-old child may give you that truth. But because it's not coming from the person you wanted it to come from, what might you do? Reject it. That's really sad. See, if we're humble, what we'll do is we'll receive the truth in whatever guise it comes. Can you see that? So allow yourself to get into a condition where you're willing to receive. Now that takes working through a lot of emotions of unworthiness. Can you see that every emotion of unworthiness I have inside of me is going to affect my ability to receive something that is good, including love